True religion, it seems, has never been popular. There's never been a culture in the world where it is cool to follow the Lord. And by the way, I'm including the Garden of Eden in my calculations. I mean, in the aftermath of the Garden of Eden, there, just between Adam and Eve and Cain and Abel, we're talking about four people, and one of them manages to murder another one. And it wasn't just an ill-fortunate encounter, it was that Abel wanted to worship the Lord the right way, and Cain was opposed to that and felt convicted just by being around Abel, and so the solution was to murder him. This is the way Scripture generally describes the world going. I mean, how many followers did Noah have? A handful, and he preached to the world. The most astonishing thing about the hostility that is usually targeted towards believers is that it generally doesn't even come from those in the world. It comes from those who are in the so-called family of God. Moses had his persecution, of course, from Pharaoh and the Egyptians, but the most severe persecution to Moses was from fellow Israelites who couldn't tolerate him. Jesus, of course, was betrayed and eventually murdered, but the immediate cause of it was the Pharisees, the Jews themselves. And how popular do you think the apostles were, by the way? Their lack of popularity was certainly most prevalent among the Jews. The Gentiles were willing to tolerate the apostles, but not so the Jews. In fact, it wasn't until the 300s when the Roman Empire adopted their form of Christianity that it was even legal to be a Christian in much of the world. When you look through world history, you are hard-pressed to find a single culture anywhere where Christianity is palatable. And this, I mean, I was reminded this week talking about reading a little thing about Calvin's Geneva. Calvin was persecuted in Geneva, of all places. I mean, you think of a place where Christianity would have been accepted. I mean, Calvin and his compadres were practically running the city on the city council, and they persecuted him. And this shouldn't be surprising to us. This goes back to John 15, where Jesus said, if the world hates you, know that it has hated me before it hated you. In other words, Jesus says, I got here first. If you were of the world, Jesus said, the world wouldn't hate you. But because you're not of the world, and he says this, but because I chose you out of the world, therefore the world hates you. In other words, the world is opposed to Christians, not necessarily just because we don't fit in the world, although that's part of it. But there's other people, there's other religions and sects of people that don't fit into the world, that are not hated by the world with the hostility that the Christians receive. No, it's because you're not of the world, but secondly, but because Jesus chose you out of the world. In other words, the hatred that much of the world has towards Christianity, it's not necessarily even about us not fitting in, it's really hatred towards the God who chose us not to fit in. Because they hate the Lord of Christ, they hate those whom Christ has chosen. And this is the way, again, it has always been this way. It's easy to fall into the trap for people to think, oh, this is the worst it's ever been. This is the worst it's ever been. Christianity's got to be on its last leg. There's not much time left. Not much longer we can last. If this election doesn't go this way, or if this Supreme Court case doesn't go that way, well, Jesus, you better come quick because it's over. Every now and then you see a tabloid like Newsweek or Time Magazine or something. publish a story about, this is the end of Christianity. It's all over but the crying, and that's coming soon. And it's amazing to me that you see a lot of evangelicals get sucked into that way of thinking. That if this event or that event doesn't go according to our plans, then there is no room left for Christianity on this culture. For those kind of people, let me introduce you to Elijah in 1 Kings 18. You think we have it bad? I mean, look at Libya. You think Libyan Christians have it bad? Look at Elijah. There's a lack of awareness, I think, in a lot of evangelical cultures. They believe if the church doesn't change X or Y, then the church is going to die. Listen, God has always had a remnant. The church isn't going anywhere. God has always had a remnant. And so this morning I want to talk to you, before we get into 1 Kings 18, about what it means when the Scripture says God has always had a remnant. I want to kind of fill out your remnant theology. Remnant is a theological word. It's used 83 times in the Bible. It's a very common word to describe what God is doing in the world. God is building his remnant in the world. That's what he's doing. Most of the uses of the word remnant are in the Old Testament, but there are many in the New Testament as well, and there's a substantial change that happens to the concept of a remnant between the Old Testament and the New Testament. I want to talk about that. Let me give you an outline here. Four components of a remnant. or four essentials of a remnant. I mean, you might think in your mind, what does it mean? The word remnant, it's kind of an English word. We use it somewhat regularly. Do you know what it means? And let me give you the four qualifications, what you need to have, four criteria to have a remnant in the Bible. First is destruction. The first component of having a remnant is some kind of destruction. A remnant is only seen in contrast with destruction, but it's not just destruction. It's destruction by God or destruction from God. In the scriptures, when it talks about this group of people known as a remnant, they are a remnant in the midst of God's wrath. Understanding that affects, it shifts the way you view the Christian's role in the culture, in the world. We're not a remnant from the world. We're not a remnant from the culture. We're a remnant preserved not from the degradation of the world, but we're a remnant preserved from the wrath of God. That's what we flee from, is God's wrath, not from the corrupting influence of the world. We don't want to be of the world, of course, but ultimately we're not a remnant running from the world. We're a remnant hiding from the wrath of God in Christ. So destruction, and that's how you see this word in the Bible. I mean, really the first example of a remnant is Adam and Eve. When they should have been killed because of their sin, God spared them. So although they were the only two people on the earth at the time, they become the preserved remnant. And that plays itself out through the rest of the Old Testament. Lot, in a sense, was the remnant from Sodom and Gomorrah. God preserved a remnant of Sodom in the form of Lot and his daughters. The first time you see the word remnant used, by the way, is Joseph talking to his brothers in Genesis 45, when his brothers ask what's going on. Remember the confrontation in Pharaoh's palace, and Joseph tells him that this is coming from the Lord. The Lord elevated Joseph, brought the Israelites into Egypt, elevated Joseph to spare them so that God would have a remnant in Egypt. It was a remnant from the destruction of God, the famine that was coming on the land. And that's what you see in 1 Kings 18. 1 Kings 18 describes this famine in Israel. And the famine is not just, you know, a meteorological or hydrological phenomenon. It's because God is disciplining the Israelites. The famine is from the Lord. He sent them a drought, no rain, because no rain, no grass, no grass, no animals, no animals, no food. There is a famine in the land from the Lord. And so when you see the concept of a remnant in 1 Kings, it's God protecting a certain set of people from his own destruction. Well, not only do you need destruction to have a remnant, but secondly, you need not just the destruction of God, but the protection of God as well. The protection of God. God's going to destroy this group of people, but inside of that is a remnant who are protected by God. Notice the double-edged sword nature here of a remnant. The sword is from God, but the remnant is protected by God. The wrath is from God and the protection is from God as well. It's by God and for God. God protects, in 1 Kings 18, his remnant in a couple different ways. We saw last week that he protected his prophet through feeding him by a raven and by a widow. We're going to see this week some prophets fed by other means, by a person bringing them food and water while they were hiding in a cave. Both are supernatural in a sense. Both are from God. God is protecting his people. And this is how you see the term used throughout the Old Testament. No matter what judgment God sends on Israel, he'll always preserve a remnant. In the Old Testament, the remnant's always inside of the nation Israel, and God will always protect them until the time of Christ, which leads to the third element of a remnant. Not just destruction from God and protection by God, but thirdly, you need election of God. God's electing, God's choosing whom he will save. And you have a basic question to ask when you're dealing with a remnant. What determines whether someone receives the protection of God from his wrath or does not? What determines if someone is inside of God's protective umbrella or outside? And this is where the New Testament picks this up. Romans 9, verse 27, Paul says this, though the number of the sons of Israel be as the sand of the sea, only the remnant of them will be saved. In other words, God promised Abraham that his offspring would be numerous, that the Israelites would be everywhere, but not all from Israel, the person, is Israel in the covenant with God. Not everyone who's Jewish is under the blessing of God. There's a subsect of that, a section of that, the remnants. And only they will be saved in Romans 9:28. For the Lord will carry out his sentence upon the earth fully, the destruction of God, and without delay. As Isaiah predicted, Paul says, if the Lord of hosts had not left us an offspring, we would have been like Sodom and become like Gomorrah. If Yahweh didn't choose to spare some from Israel, they all would have been destroyed like Sodom. But he did. He chose some to save. And in the Old Testament, they were all among the Jews. That was the remnant. And God had saved other people around the world, but the remnant was those that were in Israel. In the New Testament, that changes. Remember, the gospel goes to the world. God is no longer keeping a remnant in Israel. In fact, he delivers Israel over to destruction in 70 AD as they're scattered around the earth and the temple is destroyed. And the gospel goes to the Gentiles. Paul comes back to the early church with a report of the gospel going to the Gentiles. And you hear James, the half-brother of our Lord, render his verdict. This is Acts 15, verse 17. He says, the remnant of mankind will seek the Lord. In other words, there will be Gentiles who are now part of the remnant. And they'll be all the Gentiles who are called by my name, declares the Lord, who makes these things known from times of old. In other words, James recognizes in the destruction of Israel and the spread of the gospel among the Gentiles, God is expanding his remnant now. Now it's not in an ethnically segregated Israel. Now it is in ethnically diverse church around the world. There will be a remnant chosen by God's grace. And that's what Paul says in Acts 11, verse 2. He says, do you not know? I love it when Paul asks that question. So think, do you not know? Paul's asking you right now this morning. Do you not know what Scripture says about Elijah and how Elijah prayed about Israel, prayed against Israel? Lord, Elijah prays, they've killed your prophets. They've demolished your altars. I alone am left and they seek my life. And Paul asks you this question. Don't you know this? What's God's reply to him? Romans 11, verse 4, what's God's reply to him? I have kept for myself 7,000 men who have not bowed the knee to Baal. So too, at the present time, Paul says, this is Romans 11, 5, so too at the present time, there is a remnant chosen by grace. When you think of a remnant, understand that God will never let his church be destroyed. He will never let the true believers be destroyed because they will never be wiped off of the earth because God always has a remnant. You feel like you're the only one left. Paul says, don't you even know what God told Elijah? There's always a remnant chosen by grace. Now, there's a fourth component of a remnant, but I'm going to save that until the end. That's going to be my motivation to get through this section quickly. I need help sometimes. I'm self-motivating right now. Let's begin in chapter 18, verse 1. It happened after many days that the word of Yahweh came to Elijah in the third year, saying, go show yourself to Ahab, and I will send rain on the face of the earth. Remember, the context is that Yahweh is not sending rain to his people Israel because they're worshiping the rain god. It's poetic irony by God. You want to worship the rain god? Fine, no rain for you. And Elijah said, it won't rain until I say it'll rain. And so Ahab, their wicked Baal-worshipping, rain god-worshipping king, his solution to this is to track down Elijah and torture Elijah and get Elijah to say the word rain. That way it would rain again. It's way easier than repenting from sin, I guess. I don't know how Elijah was going to get tricked by Ahab, how Ahab was going to make him say the word rain, charades or something, I don't know. But that's Ahab's goal, find Elijah, get him to say rain. But God hides Elijah 3.5 years. I know it's 3.5 years because Jesus says in Luke 4:25 that Elijah was in hiding for 3.5 years when there was no rain in the land. He's been with the widow. The widow was happy to have him. Sure, her life was extended for being there. But now 3.5 years later, the famine is so severe that if God does not send rain to Israel, the remnant will be lost. This is a dire situation. If rain doesn't come to God's people now, the remnant itself will die off. And so God has to send rain to Israel. But God has a bit of a problem here. You see it a little bit in verse 2. Elijah went to show himself to Ahab. Now the famine was severe in Samaria. What would happen if God simply sent rain to Israel? Remember, God's withholding rain because they're worshiping the rain god. What would happen if 3.5 years later, God suddenly sends rain? Well, everybody would think, praise Baal, praise the rain god. It's raining. We knew we were right. And so God has to figure out a way to send rain to Israel where people will not give the rain god credit. It's a regular conundrum, right? But God has a plan, as I'm sure you knew he would. Verse 3, Ahab called Obadiah, who was over the household. Ahab's the wicked king. He calls Obadiah, the head of the chief of staff, who was over the household. Now Obadiah feared Yahweh greatly. You have to remember that as we go through the story. It's too easy to say Obadiah was a shallow believer or that Obadiah lacked faith. No, the inspired narrator here says Obadiah feared Yahweh greatly. Obadiah is his name means servant or slave of God. So he's obviously raised in a Christian or a covenant family where God blessing was on him. He was named as a follower of Yahweh. He's going to say later on in chapter 18 that he's followed Yahweh since he was a youth. So he was raised to follow the Lord, and yet he's been elevated in the most awful political situation imaginable, where Jezebel worships the Asherah, the sexually immoral goddess, and fills the king's palace with all these Asherah prophets. The king worships Baal, the rain god, and fills the palace with all these Baal prophets. In that awful environment, they're slaughtering those that follow God. They're slaughtering prophets of Yahweh. In that environment, Obadiah comes to power somehow. We don't know how. I read one commentator this week that guessed that Ahab just liked Obadiah around because it aggravated his wife. Ahab was looking for a way to annoy Jezebel, so fine, keep a worshiper of Yahweh around. That should do the trick. Scripture doesn't say that, but it's a nice conjecture. Anyway, this is a reminder to us that you can fear the Lord and be serving even in an awful political climate. I'm not even thinking so much of the United States, but I'm thinking of Buddhist nations and Muslim nations in the world that have essentially religious political structures, and you think, how could anybody who loves the Lord rise to power in that kind of environment, Daniel Nebuchadnezzar style? And the answer is God in his providence does that in places. It seems often, even in Ahab and Jezebel, he elevates Obadiah somehow. Why would God do that? Well, God is protecting his remnant through these means, and you're going to see this in a second. Verse 4, when Jezebel, the queen, destroyed the prophets of Yahweh, Obadiah took 100 prophets and hid them by 50s in a cave and provided them with bread and water. And we're going to find out next, in chapter 19, that it was actually over 700 of these prophets. He broke them up by 50s in different caves. And these caves are around the Mount Carmel region. And, some people are skeptical. How could you find all these caves to stash prophets by 50s in? Well, I'm glad you asked. It was in the 1970s that two UCLA professors, Richard Patterson and Herman Osteel, decided they would figure that out for themselves, and they went on a survey of the Mount Carmel region, and they counted over 2,000 caves big enough for 50 people to hide in. I tell you that just so you know I'm actually doing work during the week. I'm not just watching basketball. I learned this. So there's caves everywhere in this area. Ahab is on the hunt for Elijah. He can't find him. Meanwhile, Obadiah, Ahab's chief of staff, is hiding prophets left and right and then bringing them food and water. Verse 5, Ahab says to Obadiah, "Go through the land to all the springs of water and to all the valleys. Perhaps we'll find grass to keep the horses and mules alive and not have to kill some of the cattle." I mean, this famine is out of control. No grass. The animals are dying. And this is at the end. And so you can tell Ahab doesn't trust his people here. He's been looking for Elijah for 3.5 years and nobody can find him. Ahab gives the impression that he's starting to lose it, and he's thinking that those closest to him are lying to him about Elijah. And if they're lying about Elijah, they probably have water and they're lying about that too. But he trusts Obadiah. It's so strange. This wicked king trusts godly Obadiah. And so they decide to get to the bottom of this. Verse 6, they divided the land between them to survey it. Ahab went one way by himself. Obadiah went another way by himself. You're going to find out if there is enough water to stay alive. Now, as Obadiah was on the way, behold, Elijah met him, and he recognized him. And how do you recognize Elijah? Well, we learn in 2 Kings 1 that Elijah looked like a freak show. He had this long, mangy beard. He wore a leather strap around his waist that covered his loins. He was disheveled. He looks like an Old Testament John the Baptist because he's an Old Testament John the Baptist. And so he's easily recognizable, and Obadiah falls on his face and says, "Is this you, Elijah, my master?" Notice that Obadiah is esteeming Elijah as God's prophet and recognizing his authority and even honoring him. Verse 8, Elijah says, "It is I. Go say to your master, behold, Elijah is here." You would expect these two people to have some kind of fellowship here. They're two of the only believers left in the world, and they run into each other, and Elijah is almost discounting Obadiah, just giving him these commands here. In fact, he says, "Go tell your master, behold, Elijah is here." That phrase "is here" is not in the Hebrew. The Hebrew is just, "Go tell your master, behold, Elijah." Dun, dun, dun. Maybe the music isn't in the Hebrew, but it's implied as much as it is here. This is Elijah's plan. He wants Obadiah to go find the king who's hunting for Elijah right now in water and tell him, "Elijah's here, boom, boom, boom." And that's the plan, grand entrance. I mean, this is Elijah's style. Remember how he bursts into King Ahab at chapter 17, just busts into the throne room? That's the same plan here, only this time with an introduction from the chief of staff. Obadiah is not down with this plan though, verse 9. He says, "What sin have I committed that you're giving your servant into the hand of Ahab to be put to death?" Ahab does not buy, Obadiah does not buy this plan because, remember, Ahab is looking everywhere for Elijah. If his chief of staff, who he barely trusts as it is, walks in and says, oh, by the way, I saw Elijah today, here he is, and like Von Trapp style, nobody walks in from the door, it's going to be an awkward pause, and then Obadiah will be killed. That's the way the story will go in Obadiah's mind. So he says, verse 10, as Yahweh, your God, lives, there's no nation or kingdom where my master has not sent and searched for you. And when they say, oh, he's not here, he made the kingdom or nation swear they couldn't find you. And now you're saying, go, say to your master, behold, Elijah. Dun, dun, dun. It will come about when I've left you that the spirit of Yahweh will carry you where I don't even know. So when I come and tell Ahab he can't find you, he'll kill me. Although I, your servant, have feared Yahweh from my youth. Hasn't it been told to my master what I did when Jezebel killed the prophets of Yahweh? I hid 100 prophets of Yahweh by 50s in the cave. I provided them with bread and water. And now you're saying, go say to your master, behold, Elijah. Dun, dun, dun. He'll kill me. This is a woe is me speech if you've ever heard one, isn't it? I can't do this. Now, I don't want to get sidetracked on leadership principles here, but man, Obadiah and Elijah are two opposite people. Elijah with his beard and his leather strap and being fed by ravens, and Obadiah in the nicest suit and in the king's house and the king's chief of staff. Yet both of them fear the Lord. Both of them love the Lord. Both of them are being used by the Lord to keep his word and his remnant alive. This is God's providence. Both are godly, both are different, and yet they're going to have to work together here. Elijah, verse 15, says, as Yahweh of hosts lives, before whom I stand, I will surely show myself to him today. In other words, go for it. I'll show up, I promise. So Obadiah went to meet Ahab and told him, and Ahab went to meet Elijah. When Ahab saw Elijah, Ahab said to him, is this you, you troubler of Israel? That's very different than, oh, are you my master? That word troubler of Israel in Hebrew, it's kind of this like incantation, like a sorcery kind of word. It literally means, is this you who's cast a spell on Israel? Is this you? Are you responsible, Ahab? Are you responsible, Elijah, for the dark cloud over Israel? Is this your doing? We have a famine because of your spell, is what Ahab is saying. Elijah responds in verse 18. He said, I haven't troubled Israel. I'm not responsible for this, but you and your father's house have. In other words, no, it's your dad. You started it because you've forsaken the commandments of Yahweh and you followed the Baals. Now then, send and gather to me all of Israel at Mount Carmel, together with 450 prophets of Baal, 400 prophets of Asherah who eat at Jezebel's table. Elijah gives an ultimatum here. There's this valley in the Carmel area. You can go see it today. It's astonishing. It's this big bowl. You could easily fit thousands, tens of thousands of people there. There's a steep cliff on one side of it as a dramatic backdrop. And this is going to be the stage for this showdown. It's going to be Elijah against the 450 Baal prophets, the 400 Asherah prophets who are going to be no-shows, by the way. Jezebel keeps her own Asherah prophets at home, so they no-show this. And then all of Israel is supposed to show up there. It's a dramatic showdown, and we'll look at that showdown next week, but I want to get a sneak peek at it this week, just a little bit of it. They all show up there. We don't know how long this took to assemble. There's a space there between 19 and 20, but apparently everybody in Israel shows up, minus Jezebel and the Asherah prophets, but all of Baal's prophets are there. All the Israelites are there. Ahab sends a message among the sons of Israel, brings the prophets together in Mount Carmel. Elijah comes near all the people and says, how long will you hesitate between two opinions? If Yahweh is God, follow him, but if Baal, follow him. This is the showdown. Now, let me give you your fourth element of a remnant. A remnant has destruction by God, protection by God, election by God, and fourthly, a decision by man, a decision by you. The fourth element of a remnant is the person choosing to be in it, choosing to follow the Lord. You see this crowd here, it fits into three different categories implied. The first is implied. The first is the followers of Yahweh, the real followers of Yahweh, those who love the Lord. They're absent from this. They're hiding in the caves. We don't know where Obadiah is. They're not here. The second category of people is those that are the prophets of Baal. Ahab himself and the prophets of Baal, those are all in Baal worship. They're here. And Elijah doesn't even address them yet. He'll talk to them next week. But for now, he doesn't even talk to them. He doesn't even dignify them with acknowledging their presence. The third group is the majority of the Israelites, those who would say they love Yahweh with their lips, but with their lives are serving Baal. And they would say it because, hey, we're Israelite. Our name, we're Israelite by name, so of course we love the God of Israel, the God of Jacob. But at the same time, Ahab is king, and Baal worship is mandatory. So of course we've got to worship Baal also. Can't we do both? That's most of the people there. Can't we do both? And that is who Ahab talks to, or that's who Elijah talks to. He doesn't waste time with the Baal prophets. The Yahweh prophets aren't there. He is just addressing those people who say they love God with their lips, but in their lives they deny him so that they can serve their false Baal God. And listen, I will guarantee you there are many people here this morning that are in that category, that middle category. Now, not that you would say you worship Baal. I don't see any Baal bumper stickers in the cars or anything. You know, a Baal eating a Jesus fish or anything. Nothing like that. But I know that there are people here who follow the Lord with their lips, they follow the Lord with their feet on Sundays, and they leave the church and go back into the world with nary a mention of the Lord all week long. No affection for him, no evidence whatsoever of him at all. In fact, if somebody were to come and investigate your life and say, I wonder what this religion is, what does this person do, what is his beliefs or her beliefs, they would probably follow you to church. And they would come to church and they would deduce, oh, this person believes in a holy God. People are separated from God because of their sin. That this holy God has sent his son, Jesus Christ, to the earth, who's led a perfect life and died bearing the wrath of God for his sin. That God's anger towards his sin was poured out on Christ. Christ paid the penalty for it, rose from the grave and offers new life to those who follow him. This person follows him and has sent his Holy Spirit to seal his heart. That's what the person would deduce by watching you here on Sunday morning. But then they might follow you home and watch you for the next 6 days. And they would likely deduce, I was wrong. I see no evidence of religion in this person's life. I see no evidence of affections for Christ in this person's life. I see no evidence of being different from the world in this person's life. So maybe I was wrong about all of that. This person, maybe he doesn't have a fixed opinion about religion at all. He definitely doesn't believe that anybody would be happier being a Christian than in any other religion in the world. That's where this person must be. And that's where I fear that many people are. Jude describes those people as empty clouds. In other words, dark clouds that look like they should produce rain. There's no rain there. The person who thinks that they should be a blessing to the world, they're not a blessing to the world. They're blown across the sky without even a drop of blessing coming from their life. They act all tough. They speak like they're full of blessings. There's no blessings there at all. Spurgeon calls them empty beauties, painted but without life. This is the person who, you know, says, I'm a Christian on Sunday mornings. When they go about the rest of their life without taking a stand for the Lord, without confronting sin, without pursuing godliness in their life, and they have all kinds of excuses, don't they? Oh, you don't know how rough the world is. The kind of things Christians believe, they're just not politically acceptable right now. And I need to fit in the world. You don't know who my friends are. You don't know who my boss is. If they found out that I actually believe what the Bible said, it'd be over for me. So they're open-minded enough that I can get away with coming to church on Sunday as long as I don't post too much about it. But if they knew what the Bible actually taught, there's no hope for me there. The kind of person who says, oh, I follow Christ. The man who says, I follow Christ. I'm a godly husband on Sunday mornings. I get my family to church, aren't I? But I'm not godly enough to take a stand for Christ during the week. I'm not godly enough to love my wife and my kids and shepherd my wife and my kids and have any kind of devotional life with them at all. That's not for me. I'm just godly enough to get to church on Sunday and live like the world Monday through Saturday. Or the woman who says, I'm a godly wife. I come to church. I get my kids there on Sunday morning. Here we are. But I'm not godly enough to submit to my husband during the week or to teach my kids the basics of the Christian faith during the week. Oh, that's not my bag. Or the kid who says, I'm a godly kid. I come to church. Here I am. My friends aren't at church. Here I am. Awake sometimes, but here I am. But not godly enough or not awake enough to be kind and submissive to my parents or to share the gospel with my friends. I mean, that's out of bounds between what I would expect from any kind of religion of the scriptures. You know, it's not so much that you don't really love the Lord, it's kind of the hypocrisy of the thing. If you remember Uncle Tom's Cabin, Tom Locker rebukes Haley. Haley was a slave owner in Uncle Tom's Cabin, but Haley could preach. If you remember that book, Haley was a preacher. He could bring the thunder. And the Tom Locker finally rebukes him and says, I can stand almost any talk of yours, but your pious talk, that's what kills me right up. You're getting religious, as you call it. It's really running up the hill with the devil and then sneaking out when comes time to pay. That's the person who says, oh, I love Jesus, just not with my actual life, but I'm here, aren't I? What more do you want from me? The person who says, of course I'm a Christian. I follow Christ, but I would never be baptized. I mean, that's too much. I mean, you know how humiliating that would be to be in the water in front of everybody, making a public declaration of faith in Christ? What would people think? Of course I can't do that. What would my parents think? I mean, they would be undone if I got baptized. So that's obviously right out. You know, this phrase here, how long are you going to go limping between two opinions? It's a funny word picture in the Hebrew. Limping is, in the Hebrew, is the word for broken foot. You know, have you seen a basketball player who sprains his ankle and he hops off the court real quick before he can get help? The one-legged hopping off the court, that's the image here. And the between two opinions, it's the Hebrew phrase. The Hebrew has a word for these a split in a tree trunk, where a tree trunk splits and branches go different ways. So it's this image of a person hopping between one trunk of a tree and another, but they're doing it with a broken leg. It's funny. At Immanuel Christian graduation many years ago, Tom Coles, who works in our facilities department, he's got a whole workshop over there. He built this machine. It was two boxes. It was motorized, two boxes with a lever between it. And he had his son, who was graduating, I'm sure his son was excited about this, stand in 1 foot in both boxes in front of everybody. And he turns on the machine and it slowly starts to separate the boxes. And he has to decide, how long are you going to stand in both places? I mean, how long can you do it? Well, that's where so many people, not people in the world, remember. Much of the persecution I'm talking about is not even in the world. So many people in the church. Hey, I'm here in the church. I love Jesus with my lips. But can't I have it both ways? Can't I be a Christian and also think and love and believe like the world does? Can't I be a six-day atheist? Can't I believe in the Bible and also whatever is unpopular in the world today in the culture? Can't I do both? Are you saying they contradict each other? Absolutely, I'm saying that. And you can't do both. You cannot. And here's the kicker of this all. It's not even that you're such a hypocrite, you're here on Sundays and living with the world the rest of the week. It's that you can't make up your mind. It's not the hypocrisy of it, although on the outside that's part of it, but it's the indecisiveness of it. And you look at what Elijah says in verse 21. He says, how long will you hesitate? How long will you bounce back and forth between one branch and the other? I mean, seriously? You need more time? You can't figure this out? I'm reminded of this every, you know, presidential election cycle at the beginning of November, like the last poll comes out and it's like, you know, 25% undecided. In November. Do you need more time? Are you missing some information here that would really help fill things in for you? Like you just, I get them confused all the time. Which one is which again? But people are like that when it comes to Christ. I can't decide to serve the Lord or not. I just can't tell. Wait, which is the covenant God who brings blessings and which is the empty pagan rain God that brings curses? I get him confused. And so you become a life that just promises blessing. You use the word Christian from your lips enough to think that you can provide any blessing to anybody in the world at all, and there is not a drop of water in you because you are empty. You're limp-wristed, hopping between one branch and another with not the courage of your convictions to take a stand on either one. I mean, you get the impression here that Elijah would much rather you be Queen Jezebel or Ahab than any of the Israelites. I mean, at least they have the courage to act on their convictions. At least they'll follow through. How long will you go? This person says, oh, I can decide to follow Christ later on in my life. It's not time for it right now. Like, I'm young. If I took stands for Christ now, it could ruin my careers. I had a student tell me, yeah, I want to follow the Lord, but I can't be a member of your church because your church teaches in, this is his thing, your church teaches six-day creation, and if there's six-day creation, then I'm a scientist, and if my bosses found out that I was part of a church that believed in six-day creation, my career would be over. I picture Ahab, and I picture Elijah, and I picture Elijah just shedding a big tear for that story. Oh, you poor thing. Yeah, better run along then. I mean, really? I just need more time. Let me get my career established, and then let me get my family together. Let me have my kids at home, and then let me get on to my second career. And now let me retire and send my kids to college, and let me get like the nice retirement home, and then I'll have time to consider whether or not I want to follow Christ in my life. I just need some more time to sort through this all. A lot of ins and a lot of outs here. I got to figure this out. You know, it's harder to turn to Christ at the end of your life than it is at the beginning of your life. Because at the end of your life, by turning to Christ, you're saying that everything you lived for was worthless. You can do that at the end of your life? Better do it now. At least Obadiah, notice Obadiah's phrase, I served the Lord since I was a youth. I've always been in this. Enough with the half-heartedness, enough with the borderline effeminate leaders at home who claim the name of Christ at church on Sunday but can't man up in their families. Enough of the women that say, oh, I follow Christ, but you can't care for the things of the Lord in your own household. Enough of the indecisiveness that marks people's lives where they can put on the show at Sunday and just hope that the people they see at church on Sunday don't run into them during the week. I'm an expert in those kind of people from my time as a youth pastor. See all those high school kids raising their hands and Jesus fishing their t-shirts and praising Jesus on Sundays in church, and then you go to high school with, you know, the pizza lunch or whatever, and those kids are like, oh, I hope nobody sees me with the Christians. Because if their two worlds collided, who knows what would happen? And it's easy to ID in high schoolers. Let me tell you what, it's also easy to ID in grown-ups. Man, I hope nobody from my life knows about what I do on Sunday mornings. How long will you bounce back and forth between the two trees? How long will you keep the charade up? They hadn't had rain in 3.5 years. What more information did they need? God sent his son to die on the cross to make atonement for your sin. What more information do you need to make up your mind? Scripture says now is the day of salvation. Tomorrow is the devil's day. Today is the day to come to faith in Christ. Don't hop back and forth anymore. Lord, we're thankful that you are light that shines into the darkness. There's no confusing light and darkness. Perfect light drives out darkness, drives out fear, and it shows us how you would have us to live. Lord, I pray for the people in this church that they would have courage that matches their convictions. I pray that there would no longer be people who hop back and forth, but they would have courage to take a stand for Christ, whether it's to follow him in obedience to baptism, whether it's to profess him in front of friends, but that we would be a church marked by courageous people like Elijah and Obadiah, and not like the cowards who bounce back and forth. Lord, give us courage to act as we believe. We ask this in Christ's name. Amen.
You have been listening to Immanuel with Pastor Jesse Johnson. You can find more resources like this at ibcva.com. Here is a parting word from Pastor Jesse.
If you have any questions about what you heard today, or if you want to learn more about what it means to follow Christ, please visit our church website, ibcva.com. If you're not a member of a local church and you live in the Washington, D.C. area, we'd love to have you worship with us here at Immanuel. We're located in Northern Virginia, and for more information about when and where we worship, check out our church website. I hope to personally meet you this Sunday after our service. But no matter where you live, it's our hope that everyone who uses this resource is involved in their own local church. Now may God bless you this week as you seek Jesus constantly, serve the Lord faithfully, and share the gospel boldly.